cut, press cut, arc cut, U cut. What are all these terms? What's the difference between all of them? And that's my objective, is to really help clarify what that means. So if you're out in the wild and you find something, just to give you better insight. As far as me, I'm Freeman Moore. I'm a member of NDGA for some number of years. I don't recall how long. I'm the webmaster for NDGA. I'm also a member of the National Cambridge Collectors. That I do know for close to 20 years. My wife and I have collected glass for probably close to 30 some years. As with a lot of people, you know, from a collecting point of view, you start with one pattern or one reason and then you branch out. And that's the same with me. I branched out into other patterns. And we'll wrap up with actually the idea of near cut, which is the Cambridge version. Sort of an introduction. In terms of decorating glass, you can decorate glass by painting on it, whether or not you actually put paint on it, like enamel or silver overlay. You know, so you put something on the glass, or you could do something in the glass. So if it's in the glass, then you're either cutting into the glass or you're doing etches in the glass. So you have different ways to decorate glass. The idea of actually cutting glass, you know, goes back centuries. And even in the US, the first glass was made around 1771. And the whole idea of this brilliant cut glass, you know, really exploded after the Paris Exposition, all the intricate designs and so forth. So you'll hear the brilliant cut glass. Or is more specifically the American brilliant cut glass. I have one example of cut glass, and I will pass my two examples around. I only have the two physical examples here you can touch. I do have a display of near cut items, so you appreciate different near cut patterns. And we'll take a look at things here. The thing about cut glass is you can actually feel the sharpness, not to the point of cutting yourself, but it's a very sharp, well-defined pattern. As opposed to getting into the pressed versions, which sort of look like cut glass, but it's not as sharp to the touch. And so that really was the manufacturing side, that cut glass was very labor intensive, therefore expensive. So what could the factories do to come up with the imitation cut glass? And so they came up with pressed patterns that look pretty good, but at a fraction of the cost. So due to the high labor cost, it was expensive to produce, because yeah, someone actually had to sit at a grinding wheel and grind the pattern in here, do the cutting. Very labor intensive. How do you simplify that? You come up with the opportunity to press the pattern in the glass. So it comes out of the mold, pretty much it's done. So let me pass these around. So the little handle nappy is cut. You'll actually notice that, like I said, the sharpness, the distinctness of the pattern. Whereas on the other one, you know, you can feel a pattern, but it's much more smooth. Simple.
Is that considered brilliant?
Yes. The other thing to note, and it's more subtle, is the weight of the glass. In order to do the cutting, they actually had to have a little bit of lead in the glass to support cutting. So true cut glass can be detected by running through edges that are sharp and never smooth. So that sort of sets the context of the cut glass. I came across this terminology page of near cut, new cut, press cut, because that sort of introduces everything that we're going to get into. Three interchangeable terminologies to kind of intricate pressed glass. The beryllium cut, or the beryllium cut, like I said, has a lead content. Actually, we think of lead as being heavy, it actually supports the cutting into the glass without cracking. The reason for the classification is the fact that it looks like a mirror beryllium coated cut glass, which is actually crystal. The pressed, for the most part, does not have lead. It's just crystal. And I guess I should also mention, in case you're not aware of it, this is being recorded. So the recording will be posted on our website, so you can review it there. If anyone's interested, I can certainly provide copies of my slides here. And I put references at the bottom, so if that's something you want to follow through with on your own, you're welcome to. So let's look at the first one. First terminology of press cut. First thing, not to be confused, down here at the lower right, not to be confused with the early American press cut made by Inkerhoff. That's a particular pattern that they made, which is a pressed glass. They just simply call their pattern press cut. But that's made by Inkerhoff. But there is a mark called press cut, and it can actually appear vertically, horizontally, or sometimes I found it with the hyphen in it. And so that was the mark of McKee Glass Company. So they're the ones that trademarked that name, press cut. Now, as far as getting that name in it, process of molding glass, it's poured into a mold while the glass is hot. And then you have a plunger. A plunger that spreads the glass out uniformly against all the sides. Well, part of that plunger has that word. I guess my best analogy is like a butter press, where you have butter presses that press an emblem or a symbol onto butter. Same thing with glass, you have the plunger. And so the key to use the plunger to put the press cut mark on the inside bottom of salts. Now, in the case of salts, you could find some that were not marked. That's simply because they didn't have enough glass in there for the plunger to actually plunge all the way down. So that's the first terminology of press cut. By the key. New cut, imperial. That's one that I find actually quite a lot of pieces of new cut. And it's also interesting, you can't really see it on the screen, but under the script new cut, there's actually a little tiny phrase there. It's the word trademark. Yeah. The word trademark appears in that. Well, that was part of the advertising, but in terms of actually what was pressed in the glass, that was just the word new cut, which that little picture doesn't show that well up here. But I could zoom in on it. Now, they did remove the word new cut. Around 1932, they continued making pieces. So that's going to answer the first question, is every piece of imperial new cut marked? The answer is no. The older pieces, yes. The more recent pieces, no. But this is also a nice little book on imperial. Emphasizes the new cut pieces. Okay, so we have press cut, we have new cut, now we have art cut, which again is a mark that you'll find stamped in the glass. So one of the questions, who did art cut? Well, that would have been the simple answer is U.S. Glass, but U.S. Glass was actually a conglomeration of different companies. So that's why I put a little bit of history up here. And U.S. Glass included 17 factories, started combining, went to Tiffin, and over time, there was only the Tiffin plant that survived for U.S. Glass. So the art cut was used on the press glass, again, to emulate the cut glass. Pieces that are marked art cut, then they would be U.S. glass. Plunger cut. Well, right away that term reinforces the making of the glass. You've got the plunger going into it. That's Heise's term. It's also interesting in that I found a reference that refers to plunger cut as a molded mark, but I have not been able to find any pictures whatsoever of a Heise piece that actually shows that mark. So I don't know for sure if that was a physical mark or an advertising approach. So again, it was used to describe it, and the ads, I found a particular ad from China Glass and Lamps in 1906. In that particular ad, they referred to the Diamond Age and plunger cut glassware. So if anyone knows of any physical pieces of Heise that are marked, I'd like to know. At this point, I don't know for sure. We've expanded our repertoire to plunger cut Heise. Then we have deep cut. That it's deeper than anyone else. It's just, again, a different company's name to identify their product. Westmoreland Glass Company used the deep cut terminology. Not all of their pieces are marked. In fact, as a general rule, you don't find everything marked. So you have to recognize it in the patterns of different companies. My focus is really just helping understand. If you saw something and it had this word in it, what does that root word mean? So it's resca, art cut, now the plunger cut, now the deep cut. So deep cut is Westmoreland's. Clear cut. Adding to this in terms of this one, I've spent a lot of time talking with a friend of mine, Sandy Rainbow Walker. And the best we can determine is that it was never physically used in the glass. It was strictly an advertising term. That's all we've been able to find out. So this is New Martinsville. So it had, again, part of their advertising, clear cut. Certainly we find examples of the New Martinsville clear cut patterns. It's just that everything that Sandy and I have been able to locate, as well as all the advertising we found in catalogs, we don't believe it was actually used as a marketing device. And then mirror cut. Mirror cut is more my specialty because that's the Cambridge version. As a mark, sometimes it's one word, mirror cut. Sometimes it's over top, near over cut. I've even seen a few places where they've had it on a curve, like the inside of a bowl. It's been curved, mirror cut. So the Cambridge mirror cut dates really to around 1904. That's when Cambridge trademarked that phrase. History point of view, Cambridge sort of discontinued near cut around 1922. That was the last usage of near cut. So if we find near cut pieces of Cambridge, then we've got it narrowed down 1904, 1922, And then based upon the pattern, you can narrow it down even further. So the feather dish that I passed out, that is a Cambridge meerkat pattern, inverted feather. It's not marked, but it does fall within the time frame, actually more about 1910 to 1922. The same idea that Cambridge was taking the pressed patterns, making them look good enough to be the poor man's version of the brilliant cut glass. Now, if you have a chance to look at the display I have out front, I also wanted to highlight some treatments on meerkat. Certainly the idea of the ruby fly sheet was common. You know, lots of companies did that as well. It was a way of adding a little color afterwards. And then whether or not they ruby flashed like a solid portion or I need to go back to my very first page. Center here, that's a meerkat pattern by Cambridge, and then they just did what's called the ribbons in the ruby flash, and then the gold accents around the top. So that was a nice decorative touch to it. So you still took the glass as it came out of the mold, and then you did a little finishing to it. Now I'm going to zoom back down to like I said, my objective was really to raise your awareness of the different terms. So we started about the idea of decorating glass. So you could decorate by painting, you know, doing enamels, doing silver overlay. So that's one part. You could do etching on glass, which is really acid etched. So there you have all the different, you know, whether that's rose point, which is etched, or Fosteries Navarre, which is etched patterns. Or you can then press the pattern. So that's where you have depression glass a lot. It's left pressed into the mold. Well, that's the same thing with, you know, the near cut, the arm cut, the new cut, all of those. They are pressed patterns. It's just that their history is for pressed patterns to be imitation cut glass. Not really fake imitations, but something that people, a person could afford. And now, for Brad's benefit, the quiz. So, just a little bit on the brilliant cut glass, because that sets the context for understanding why companies came up with the pressed version that looked like it. So some people have lost generically used the early American press glass. It's a very broad terminology, but early American press glass, it is. So now if it's press cut, it's if it's new cut, imperial. If it's art cut, US glass. If it's plunger cut, it's Heisey. If it's deep cut, Westmoreland. If it's clear cut, New Martinsville. And if it's near cut, it's Cambridge. So that's the difference between the near, the art, the new, the press cuts, and all that. Different companies all trying to do the same thing, which was to market glass that people could afford without going to expense of brilliant cut glass. And that's what I want to share with you today. Comments, questions, anything you want to share?
So do you know anything about the brilliant cut piece? It looks like the same feather pattern as the near cut.
Yes. And that's why specifically I have those two pieces. It's one of those things that companies sometimes came up with original patterns. Sometimes they copied somebody else. And in this case, it appears that Cambridge copied a brilliant cut pattern. So, because that is the older piece.
Which company is made brilliant?
Not sure if I could actually identify companies there. That's sort of outside my area. I only have like two pieces of brilliant cut glass. The one I have there, I was lucky to find it. Most of the others tend to be expensive too. Thank you.